Autumn with you.
Yeah.
Him, her, whatever.
Amen.
Because there is no gender discrimination.
Yes.
I just love the Lord.
Yes. Yes.
What's wrong with that?
Hey. I just love the Lord. And I love being with people who also love the Lord. My sermon today is called No Deposit, No Return.
Amen.
Because if you don't put anything in, you can't get nothing out.
All right. That's right. You better preach now.
Come on.
Come on.
Yeah. You better
preach. I just want you to be able to understand that prayers never expire, but if we don't put anything in them, then we get nothing.
Well, right now,
I'm going to take my scripture from Luke, the 16th chapter, 19th through 31. I didn't put it in the bulletin because it was just a little too much for me to put into a bulletin. But what it is the parable of Lazarus.
Yeah.
Okay? So that's what we're going to be talking about. Lazarus begging at the gate.
Yeah.
How many of us are begging at a gate? Not so much today. Well, not today anyway.
Amen.
God is blessing us.
Amen.
He is blessing us. And we don't have to wait until we are no longer in this realm to enjoy our blessings.
That's right. That's right.
There it is.
That's right.
I remember growing up and they say, the older people used to say, it'll be over soon. I'm like, I don't want it over soon, I want it over now. As you know, we are in the process of rallying to buy a new church.
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because this is going to happen.
Yeah.
That's right.
Okay? But I just want you to understand how it all works into God's plan. Mm-hmm. And how the Spirit of the Lord wants to work with us.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In loving each other.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
In helping each other.
Mm-hmm.
In helping our church grow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I walk the streets a lot and I see people begging all the time. Can you spare a dime? Can you give me a quarter?
Mm.
You know? So I have a set amount, my pastor taught me, a set amount per day that is given to the homeless. I can't give you all my money because then I'll be homeless. Okay? But I'm saying this is because we are in the process of building or gathering finances together to move into a new church.
Mm-hmm.
That's ours.
Yes.
And I don't know about anybody else, but I'm excited about the whole thing.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Starting at the 19th chapter, at the 19th verse of Luke, who wishes to follow with me, there was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table.
Wow.
Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. Imagine that. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. And he lifted up his eyes in Hades. And called out in torment. He looked up and saw Abraham not far away with Lazarus by his side. And the rich man said, could you send him down to just touch my tongue with some water?
Yes, there it is.
How does the tables turn? But Abraham said, child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed. So he could not, even if he wanted to, go and help him. There was a space that he couldn't cross.
That's right. Well.
So he said then, I beg you to send him to my father's house. I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so they will not also come to this place of torment. Abraham replied, they have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them. He said, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. He said to him, if they did not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone came from the dead. In this parable, Jesus tells how the rich man did not have the heart of giving of his resources or himself. He had ample opportunity to give out his abundance to Lazarus, but seemed more interested in feeding his own hungry than Lazarus' hunger. Eschatological images aside, this parable teaches us that when we fail to deposit what we have and who we are in the lives of others, that we can expect nothing in return.
That's right.
Right. Now, how this ties into us is I am now part of the trustee group. And I get to see the funds coming in and all that stuff.
Thank you.
So I had to regroup myself and be a cheerful giver. Because this is our house. This isn't their house. We are borrowing their house, but we want our own house. So in order to get that house in today's time, we have to give a little more. We have to sacrifice some things. Because God already has given us the victory, is wrote in our destiny. It's already there. It's there. All we have to do is act upon it. And how do we do that? We said we wanted a new building.
That's right.
So what are we doing to get that new building?
Come on, man. Come on.
Well, I can't speak for anyone else, but I can speak for myself. I do the best I can every week to make sure Unity, my family, has their tithes as I pay the bill. That was my personal commitment. You have the choice to make your personal commitments and how you want to work with it. But we are moving to a better place that we will not have any time limits on. I gotta watch the clock because I can't preach over 15 minutes.
Take your time.
I'm just saying. Because we have a time period to be out of the sanctuary so other people can come in.
Yeah.
If we wanted to have other programs after service, we could do that freedom comes with having your own.
Say that again.
Yep.
I just want you to understand, and I'm all about being free in all areas of my life.
Yes.
You know, it's not just about knowing Jesus and what Jesus wants and how, it's how we are going to work with what we already know. Discard the stuff we don't need anymore and move forward into a new generation. Reverend DJ preached last week, a new beginning.
New beginnings.
And where does that start? It begins and ends with me.
That's right.
Who knew?
That's good stuff.
Who knew?
Can't make it more.
You know,
thank you.
I just want you to understand how important this is. So when we are asking you for monies for tickets and raffles and stuff, we're for a purpose. We have a purpose.
That's a purpose.
You know, I've been to churches that just bag, and I still don't know understand what the purpose was.
Hallelujah. You said something there.
Okay, but I couldn't stand up and say I'm a lesbian and I love Jesus, not in the same sentence. I just had a classmate ask me, well, how do you graduate from a Bible school and you're elevated to minister and you're a lesbian? Who knew? Jesus loved lesbians too.
Who knew?
When we say Jesus is love and love is for everyone, it's not discriminating about who you sleep with, what club you go to, what clothes you're wearing.
That's right.
It's not decisive. It's inclusive.
That's
what Jesus came for, to include everyone. Everyone. And if you think you're not included, please get with me after the service, because I'm here to tell you, we're all included in Jesus' plan.
Come on, man. Say that.
Everybody. That's right.
Every one of us. Every one of us has a job to do.
Yes.
Your job can't be my job, and my job can't be your job, but I need you just as you need me.
Thank you.
To complete the circle of life.
Yes.
Say so.
You know.
Thank you, Lord.
We are going to be moving and shaking, as they say.
Moving and shaking.
In 2018. Because we are working with a purpose purposefully. Okay, because we have work to do, and not only is Philadelphia going to move, when Philadelphia moves, that increases the entire movement.
Yes, sir.
Because we are a collective unit.
Yeah.
So when one succeed, we all succeed.
Good God,
you know, Jesus just did not come for one. He came for us all. We are the ones with our religious doctrine segregated things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We say, oh no, you don't fit in our mold. So you can't, we can't deal with you. Okay? And we do that every day that we're alive. We see people that are dressed a little different or have a different accent, and we kind of separate ourselves from those people. Well, we have to learn how to embrace everyone.
Hallelujah.
Whether you have a job, whether you have a car, whether you have shoes, whatever.
Mercy.
We're all in this human race together.
Yes, we are.
And it doesn't matter who is sitting in the White House. We still are going to survive, and we're going to do it together. We are going to do this thing together. Because if we can't do it together, we're not going to be able to do it at all. Because together we stand, divided, we fall. Jesus wants the best for his children. And we are adopted in the family of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I don't know if y'all understand how adoption works, but you can't be kicked out of adoption.
That's great.
I mean, we're in there. we slid under the wire, but we're in there. And he can't do nothing about it, cause he can't lie. That's not in Jesus' characteristic.
Right.
So let us understand and be motivated to do a little bit better in our finances, whether it's taking care of bills or just taking care of yourself. And last but not least, please do not forget about your self-care.
It's critical. It's critical. It's critical.
Important. Because if you're not on your A game, you going to bring the B game. And I don't want you to bring the B games. I want you to bring the A game.
A game.
Hallelujah.
And be excited about it because we get to work for Jesus Christ in the process. If your life is not the way you want it today,
change.
Just hold on because change is going to come.
Hallelujah.